So
Start is up to me. So no, you're just fine. So as Phil went through, the last several months have just been an escalation of a revolutionary process. And it's based upon ideas that living human beings through the centuries have fought, lived their lives and fought for, that we are in a situation we are here today. I mean, Xi Jinping, the president of China, in October last year in Kazakhstan, called for the building of economic belts of the new Silk Road. A number of us were really excited because we knew that this was us, that we had done it. But then, since then, everything has come together that Phil pointed out, with Russia, with the new elections in India, and in a very wonderful way, Argentina standing up saying there is a limit to the tyrant's power. This small country, comparatively, had further consolidated half of the population in the world to get a new system, which we have been fighting for all the years I've been a member of this organization, which is 40 next spring. So what I'm going to do is to give a historical background for these ideas, because it is only history is shaped by human beings acting with ideas or not acting. And I will prove tonight, I hope, that we did this. We, as the Schiller Institute and the LaRouche organization, we created the situation that half of the world's population now is moving on the American system and for a new just world economic order. This was our work. And I hope that this will give us more strength and inspiration to fight like hell in the weeks and months and years ahead to consolidate this for the sake of hundreds of years to come for future generations. Just for fun, I mean, one other thing, I will tell you that in this is going to be somewhat personal, because I'm going to give you a slice of the developments we have been involved in, which I particularly has been involved in. So there's many other things that has happened in this process that I have not been privy to. But even this slice of the process, I think, will give you a clear idea that we did it. Just for fun, so the word for crisis in Chinese is wei ji, and wei means danger, and ji means to be on the edge. But if you then take these two, put this away, ji hui, opportunity. So we are in a situation now where we have, since the winning of America, since the American Revolution and the founding of this nation, we have the greatest opportunity since then for creating a world that is for human beings, of a new just world economic order. We actually have it in our hands. We have to win the situation in the United States. We have to get a puppet out of the United States. The support in the population for LaRouche and for these ideas are there. People are just terrified. We have it in our hands, and we have half the world's population now with these ideas. The only thing we have to do is to clean up in the house of America, and that is get the scum out of the way, Obama, and get Glass-Steagall in, and things will roll, because we have made the basis inside this country for decades. It's ready to be harvested. But that means we have a lot of work to do, and we cannot go on holiday and relax. Particularly now, we push. So when I was When I was 25 in 1975, I met Lyndon LaRouche, and I was I had always thought that we could not we would always have hungry people in the world. I used to send a specific amount of money to Africa every year to feed a child. And then I got the ideas of LaRouche, and I could, with my own eyes, I could see, wow, this is all political, that people are starving in Africa, this is colonialism, this is all political. And there is a solution to it, because LaRouche had put out, just as I came around, he had put out the ideas of creating a new just world economic order. And an international, and create an international development bank, which should function as a vehicle for giving long-term, cheap credit for investment for a great infrastructure developments. This was the very first we went out with in Denmark. In a very bad Danish translation, the very first we went out with in the streets, the unemployment centers, and so forth, was an international development bank. And in 1976, the year after, Indira Gandhi gave a speech at Sri Lanka, the non-aligned movement in Sri Lanka, where she called for a new just world economic order and laid out the ideas of Lyndon LaRouche. And being young at the time, I thought, wow, we have won. And we actually had a party in the office in Copenhagen because that was it. We had won the battle for a new just world economic order. Indira Gandhi was a close friend of LaRouche. She was assassinated. Her son, Rajiv Gandhi, worked with LaRouche. He was assassinated. And then we had decades of hard work, good work. And this is what I'm going to go through. But first, I have to give some background historically, because we don't come out of the blue. Now in the last 40 years, we are based upon ideas and lives and fights that other people have fought before we came on the scene. And I will have to go through that first. But first of all, this world land bridge with these corridors that you can see spanning from the tip of Africa and to the, all the way over to the tip of Latin America. One thing I really ask people to have in their mind is that this is a map for anti-imperial policy, for anti-oligarchical policy. This is a map for human beings. This is a map where if you, well, like, let me give you a quote. One guy called Adam Brooks in 1801, he said, "We must make sure that the land people never succeed in developing their land, because then we, the maritime powers, will have lost our power forever." And what you've seen with the British Empire is, through the centuries, controlled choke points, set up wars in Europe, set up wars in Africa, loot Africa, set up wars in Asia, divide and conquer, and then sit outside, control everything, control raw materials, control the, now the banking system, and so forth. And that has been through like this for centuries. Now we finally have come to a situation where this planet, as it says in the Bible, go out, what do you call it, multiply, subdue the earth and take dominion over it. That we have a situation where we, with a little bit of luck and good work, have the foundation ever. In my entire life, I've never seen us have an opportunity, a jihui, the way we have an opportunity now for actually making this a world where every single child will have the opportunity to use his or her capabilities to do good and have a purpose with their life. And that is the situation we have now. And that is what that map represents. That is that we, with these corridors that spanning over the land map, that this is not just transportation. This is building a new beautiful cities that are for human beings, with centers of science and arts and parks, infrastructure where you can get anywhere in the city in a matter of 20 minutes with public transportation, most of it underground, where you have water management, power generation, agriculture being built up, because you want to have this functioning as, if you want, as a gigantic 100 miles assembly line corridors where you make the entire globe come alive, where we can take the resources out of the earth, process it, transport it, transport goods and people, and develop the entire earth. And there is a lot of places in this world of ours that are completely empty and underdeveloped. Also have in mind how fast China has developed in the last 20 years. And think about if you have half the world's population and then add America shortly to it, the acceleration of development internationally will go extremely fast. We will have just 10 years if we have no more hunger in the world. That could be done, absolutely. It will just take off with a collaboration for the mutual development and the advantage of the other. The rate of development internationally will just be really that you have an accelerating speed of development internationally. So now let me, and this is the nightmare for the oligarchy, for the empire, and that is why with the financial bubble we have now, which is completely fictitious and bankrupt, we have a danger of war, because they're only, with half the population now for mankind, with half the population in the world now for the American system, based upon the ideas upon which this nation was created, this is now half the world. As Xi Jinping, the Chinese president, said to Argentinian president, I want us to collaborate around creating a new world order, around creating a new financial system, a new financial order. That is his words, and that is the way they are thinking. So, so that is also where, when you say Weiji, it's a crisis. It's the only way out they have is war. But if we take the British public out of the United States, the danger of war will be gone. Okay, so let me give you, and please stick with me, I'll be brief, somewhat brief, but the ideas of the United States was a lot of fight for hundreds of years in Europe, in different Renaissance periods in Europe, regarding the nature of man. That is, man was not a subject, man was not a slave, but that there is something unique innate in every single human being, and that the idea is to create the optimal development possibilities, therefore, for each human being, that there's something very different from man and the animal. And one of the very good friends of Lyndon and Helga LaRouche, Wilhelm Leibniz, Gottfried Leibniz, he was very excited and interested in China in the last 30 years of his life. And he had the idea regarding development of Eurasia. He thought, let's take the most cultured and developed nations in Europe and the most cultured nation of Asia, namely China, and let them spread out their hands and cultivate the area in between. Also, Leibniz, the ideas of Leibniz was a conscious effort from the British to keep the ideas of Leibniz away from the founding fathers in the United States. But through a lot of conspiracies and so forth, the ideas of Leibniz was gotten in the hands of the founding fathers of the United States. And one of the key concepts in the Declaration of Independence, we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, born with certain inalienable rights, among them is life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. The idea of happiness comes from Leibniz. And that is not just being happy, happy, that's the idea of wisdom, of felicity, of pursuing of enhancement of the individual's creativity. So that is an inalienable rights for every single human being, and that is what became in the Declaration of Independence directly from Leibniz, who wanted, had the own, his own idea, anti-oligarchical idea, to develop the landmass in Eurasia. Here we have John Quincy Adams as an older man, as an older statesman. This was the president who made a continental nation of the United States. This was a gentleman which I am daily inspired by, because after he had had a life of being a senator, an ambassador to five different nations, being Secretary of State, being President of the United States, he ends up the last 18 years of his life in the US Congress, and everything is falling apart. Everything this his forefathers had fought for in founding the United States was falling apart. The slave holders got more and more power. You had a total destruction of the nation, with Jackson coming in, depression at the time, and so on. And John Quincy Adams writes in his diary as an old man when he is a congressman, he says that he thinks that a civil war is absolutely necessary, and it will come, a sublime war, because of the question of slavery. And he also writes, and this is my point, he also writes that this was the best years of my life. That is, here you have a man who has been in public service since he was nonstop, since he's a young man. Everything is falling apart around him. And he thinks and foresees, forecasts that US is going to be in a civil war. And he says it's the best years of my life. Why? Because he was fighting for the necessary ideas, knowing, being the man he was, that those ideas were going to bear fruit in the future. And indeed, they did. Lincoln would not have been possible without John Quincy Adams. And that's a longer story. But John Quincy Adams and a gentleman called John Jay, one of the founding members of the United States, a gentleman called Boudinot the Fourth. That's a funny family, because it's also a funny name. His father was a part of Benjamin Franklin's junta, and Boudinot, as he was either a congressman or senator from New Jersey, he was key in getting Hamilton elected to Treasury Secretary. And when Hamilton was a young man and came from St. Croix to come came to the United States, he stayed at the Boudinot family where he was groomed. I'm just giving you some of that because in 1812, when the British again tried to subdue the United States, remember later on they burned down Washington, you had the battle at Fort McHenry, you had big battles in upstate New York between the British and the American colonial Americans. Then you had efforts to manipulate Napoleon to go against Russia. That was all in 1812. What do these gentlemen decide? They decide to form something called the American Board of the Commission for Foreign Missionaries, ABCFM. And the idea is to, it's totally anti-colonial. The idea is to spread the ideas of the United States, the most beautiful ideas in terms of the Declaration of Independence and the preamble of the Constitution. And most of the leadership around the ABCFM came out of the fierce battles in upstate New York against the British, and that kind of really honed them in that they needed to think in terms of getting the ideas that the United States represented, to get that over to Asia, because the British were going all over the world, in Africa, in Asia, subduing the nations. Subduing, is that the right word?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Subduing the nations. And so what these, the idea was not just to turn people into Christians. The key idea was to spread the idea to do good and the founding principles of America. That was the key idea. And they would recruit one or two of people, however they would have come over from Japan or from Hawaii, from China. And then they would teach them Greek, Latin, geometry, science, particularly medicine and agriculture. And if they didn't have a language, these missionaries would teach, would make a written language, which for example was the question with Hawaii. So I have a case example which a dear friend of ours who is now passed away, Mark Kelney, did a major study, because one of the key hub for these missionaries was Hawaii. And you have to think in terms of 1812, 1820, 1830. We didn't have a transcontinental railroad. So the idea was to cross the United States, and think about what that took in those days. And so cross the United States and then cross the Pacific to go to Japan, to Hawaii, Japan, Thailand, Vietnam, China, to spread the ideas of the United States as a counter. Again, that's how I wanted to say today, ideas shape history. And the ideas from those guys were spread the ideas about the United States as a counter to what the British Empire represent. And the hub was Hawaii, which is clear because it's a stepping stone to get over to Asia. And I will claim that if it hadn't been for those missionaries going to Hawaii, first time they went there was 1820, Hawaii might not belong to the United States today. Mm-hmm. So the first, in 1820, you had 15 people going to Hawaii. So this was a printer, a farmer, a doctor, two teachers, and four Hawaiian recruits. And Hawaii did not have a written language, so they made a written language, and then they set up a printing shop, they had a printer, and they began to print books, and then they began to teach. And 6 years later, 1826, they had recruited 400 native assistant teachers that were teaching 25,000 students. They did that in 6 years. In 11 years, after 11 years of being there, starting with 15 people, they had 1,100 schools and that was educating 40% of the population. And then as a byproduct, after 23 years in 1843, 27,000 had converted to Christianity. It was one of the most educated and literal sections of the population at that time, if you regard Hawaii at that time as being part of the United States, which it wasn't. But in 1842, you had the Treaty of Nanjing. In 1829, as I wrote up there, this is a big, big story, so you should know I'm only skimming the surface. This is like a whole other presentation. You had so many missionaries going not only to Hawaii, but to China, Japan, and so on. And I'm only going to mention one. It was an important one, but there's many other very important missionaries, but this would just be going too far. In 1829, David Abil, one of the American missionaries, goes to China. And here he is. And he starts learning China. He's in the southern part of China. He begins to study the culture, get a master of the language, and so forth. And in 1842, he meets one of his best students ever. 1842 is also the year where there is a great upheaval in China, because the British had imposed free trade of opium upon China. And when the Chinese didn't want the opium, they declared war on China and subdued China. And at the Treaty of Nanjing in 1842, they took five major cities, including Shanghai and Hong Kong. There were signs outside the parks in Shanghai, Chinamen and dogs not allowed. So you can imagine if you had that here in Los Angeles, Americans and dogs not allowed. That was what you had. And total humiliation for China. So it was the exact same trading houses that in the name of free trade was trading in slaves. It was exactly the same financial houses that were enforcing opium on China and then subdued China when China said, we do not want our population to be dropped out. And in that very year, the Royal Navy attacks Hawaii. They burn the Hawaiian flags, they change names and so forth, they impose high taxes. This is also a story. Hawaii gets won back. I mean, Hawaii is very strong because of the teachings that had been taking place, but this all happens in 1842. That year, too, a bill meets Xu Ji Yu, who is the very powerful man. In the southern part of China, you have a province called the Fujian province. That is where you have the big town of Guangzhou. And he is the governor of Fujian. And David Abil writes about Xu. He says, he is the most inquisitive student I ever had. He just asks questions and asks questions and asks questions. And he says, I don't think he's ever going to convert to Christianity, but he's a real good student. And he never converted to Christianity, but he came to play a crucial role. So what Abil teaches, he has brought all these maps from the whole world, and what he teaches the Chinese Xu, he teaches him all the different countries in the world, the cultures of the countries of the world. And it is very important in the question about China at the time. Here had China been humiliated or subdued. Xu looked at the French, Dutch, British and so forth, like really nasty, just coming in, gobbling up China. But they had no idea about the world. So it really gave them an idea about the outside world. And this results in that in 1850, he writes, Xu writes, a brief analysis of the world, where he writes about the whole world. And this becomes a crucial, crucial importance in China because the leadership all read this book. And a key section of the book is about the United States of America, where Xu talks about George Washington, how great he is, and they don't have any counts and kings and emperors, and he is George Washington. There's something like he called it by selection. George Washington, he adhered to Confucian ideals about that the world belongs to all the people. And 3 years later, in 1853, some of the missionaries and some of the Chinese actually get a stone block over from China in Chinese, which you can see in Washington, D.C. at the Washington Monument, which was being built at that time. So there you have in Chinese coming out of this whole process where they praise George Washington as the greatest. They also, Xu compares some of the greatest people in Chinese history, some of the greatest Chinese warriors, as compared to Washington. He is the greatest. So, this became, there was a whole process that came out of that of historians and political leaders and scholars at the time that studied that book intensely, Xu's book. Laying the foundation for, I want to just interject here too. Of course, in Hawaii, when you later on had the election of Lincoln, they had a mock election in Hawaii. And the biggest percentage of vote for Lincoln came from Hawaii. Although it didn't count in the election, but they had a mock election. Another thing to think about how American leaders thought at the time. You know that during the Civil War we built the Transcontinental Railroad. You would think, if you thought practically, should we use the money for something else than building a railroad? But they were thinking on the future, and therefore the Transcontinental Railroad was built. What they also did in the middle of the Civil War as a counter, as a key flank, was that between 1860 and 1870, 200 Americans were sent to Japan. And that made a foundation which made it possible for the father of modern China, Sun Yat Sen, to do what he had to do when he was organizing to overthrow the Emperor of China. And we come to him in a second. If I'm going too fast or something and you can't follow, just interrupt me, okay? So here we have, I think he is my favorite historical revolutionary. He was born in 1866 and was intensely, influenced by this whole process of the American missionaries. And so he arrives in Hawaii in 1879. He's 13 years old. And when he comes to Hawaii, I have this beautiful quote, but I'm not going to read it. He just said, "This is my Hawaii," and so he's. And there he meets the missionaries. You can imagine this whole basis that I told about how intensely Hawaii had been saturated with the ideas of the United States. And his brother sends him away after some years because he gets so much into revolutionary ideas, Republican ideas based on the United States and so forth, and his brother is a Buddhist, and he said, "Get away from Hawaii." So Sun Yat-sen goes to Hong Kong, and he gets baptized by one of these American missionaries, and he studies medicine in a hospital in Hong Kong that was built by the American missionaries. And then when he is 18, he has one of his friends have sent they had sent people around in China to see how the population was doing. The population was devastated and very poor. And so Sun Yat-sen, as a young man, he writes to the Emperor of China that certain things needs to be done to change the situation for the population. And when he doesn't get a response back, he decides that the Emperor, 18 years old, that the Emperor must be overthrown. And one thing is that you can take a decision, but if you really, and that's, I think we should think in terms of what we are doing over the next weeks and months ahead here in the United States, and take certain, not just the pledges, but kind of think about the situation carefully and take certain decisions, because when you take certain decisions to do something and you really take the decision, you could do miracles. I mean, that's really how miracles are being made. And so Sun Yat-sen took such a decision that the emperor was going to be overthrown. And he did it. It took him 8 years to recruit three other people. They were called the Four Arc Rebels. In the first battle, two of those died. He traveled six times, and think about the times at the time, six times around the globe to set up support groups all over the world. His biggest support group was in Japan, and that came directly out of the Americans that had been sent to Japan between 1860 and 1870. He comes to the United States a lot, secretly, where he travels to New York City, to San Francisco, here in Los Angeles. He comes incognito because he is checking out the military schools that he set up secretly to train 2,100 Chinese officers recruited from the Chinatowns in New York City, San Francisco, and here in Los Angeles. We have pictures of it, actually. I don't have the picture. And if it hadn't been for those 2,100 officers, it's very unlikely that the revolution could have been won. They're smuggled back into China. So this is, in 1911, the emperor is overthrown. Sun Yat-sen thinks through all the time completely, and he takes completely responsibility for China. That is, he takes up the question about what are the problems ideological that China has, that you can read in a wonderful book called The Memoirs of a Chinese Revolutionary. He writes a book in 1917, The Vital Problem of China. This is this little book. This is so powerful that I read it in English, and then I asked all my Chinese friends, including Chiang Kai-shek's son, about this book, if they had read this book. This is the most devastating attack on geopolitics and the British that I ever read, apart from our own material. Sun Yat-sen is clear that if we defeat the British Empire, we will have no problem. And this is a longer story, so I'm not going, but this, it turned out that none of my Chinese friends knew this book. So I had a Chinese friend going into Columbia University Library and get the old microfilms and type the whole thing up. And when this came out, some people, some Chinese people were furious. Some of the generals I met said, this book should never have been published, never. And I said, well, this is so nasty. It should never have been published because it is, the reason, the last time this was published was in 1947, until we did it. That's how powerful this was, to kind of take the veil away and show the enemy in all its nastiness and littleness. That the oligarchy is not that strong if people rise up with ideas. So, importantly, what we come to is in 1919, and I would really recommend that very highly, he writes on the international development of China, and that has all to do with the world language. And it's very similar to the situation we've been in the last four decades. He writes that, he writes it a month after the Treaty of Versailles, after the First World War. And he writes in the preface that with the Versailles Treaty, we are going to have, the foundation is laid for a Second World War. That unless his program on the international development of China is adopted, a Second World War is inevitable. He then goes through, he writes it in English, and he then goes through in detail how China should be developed with development corridors, building, making, building five new harbors, the Three Gorges Dam, reforestation, crisscrossing China with railroads, continuing across Eurasia, down into the Middle East, crisscrossing Africa. He says all in great detail and all the key development corridors we have defined today comes from Sun Yat-sen. So, and he sends it out to the world's government, and in the United States he gets a message back, and guess what the message is? We can't afford it. There are people though, you have Rathenau in Germany, is very excited about it. Actually, Rathenau and Sun Yat-sen had study groups on Friedrich List on national economy, and together with one of the leading Russians. And actually, Sun Yat-sen is so excited about the German-American Friedrich List that he says, this book must be translated into Chinese. And it is translated into Chinese, Friedrich List's book. So Rathenau says he's very excited about this idea, so he discusses with Sun Yat-sen to send people to Shanghai from Germany to now begin to work on Sun Yat-sen on the international development of China. But Rathenau gets killed, and the Hong Kong Shanghai Banking Corporation puts out an award of $500,000, live or dead, on Sun Yat-sen's head. And the guy is being hounded and so forth. And all kinds of, after Rathenau's being killed, everything unravels. And The British then set up to create a civil war inside China. The idea is to split China up in two parts, a communist north and a Kuomintang south. Exactly the same thing as for the United States. Don't develop the land, don't have collaboration around developing the land, but set people up in civil wars, get people to fight each other. Sun Yat-sen writes that exactly what they did in China is what they did with the Civil War in the United States. The Confederate South supported by the British and so forth. So, well, I better be careful. This is San Min Ju Yi. This is the three principles of the people. And in that book, this is of the people, by the people, and for the people. And Sun Yat-sen goes through this in quite some detail, in particular concerning on the creation of the basis for people's livelihood. And he cites again and again Abraham Lincoln as being his inspirer for the three principles of the people. He also created a constitutional framework for based also upon the United States, just in two more branches, but it's totally based on otherwise, how the United States has, he says, has to be with Chinese characteristics, that's how he puts it. And here we have, some of you have seen this before, but some of you have not. You can see there's a map of China, and then there's a star that was used to be on China's flag in the middle. And then you have, to the one side, you have Abraham Lincoln, of the people, by the people, and for the people. And then you have Sun Yat-sen with the same thing in Chinese underneath his face. And there was a stand to raise money for the war in 1942, that is under Roosevelt. To give you a certain idea, sense of how some people thought at the time. So what I'll do now, I'll make a shift to come to the United States and what we have done here and in Europe and in China. But, and it's going to be just a slice of the cake, so to speak. This is Phil in 1985. He was running for governor of New York and then he was running for mayor of New York. And one of the things that happened was the Hong Kong and Shanghai Banking Corporation, which is a real dirty bank for centuries, has been involved in drugs, money laundering, and they continue to get scot-free again and again. Just last year, they were declared to be criminals, and they got scot-free of some billions in a fine. So we were having a special campaign in connection with Phil's running for mayor against the Hong Kong Banking Corporation's offices in New York. And that caught the attention of the Chinese. So actually, for the first time, we really got an inroad into the Chinese through that campaign. And during this period, too, we were, of course, deploying in the streets in New York and so forth. And LaRouche had given out a book called No Limits to Growth, which was a counter to the Club of Rome, Limits to Growth, that is, the new. Anyway, I will not explain that. So LaRouche wrote this book, No Limits to Growth. It is bought by a Chinese gentleman on the street. And at that time, still in 1980, in the 1980s, it was quite limited still who could leave from China. And you had to leave your wife or your husband behind. And it was not so easy as it is now, where everybody can travel. And so this gentleman brought this book back to China. He showed it to a higher official who took it home and read it and gave it back to the gentleman who had been in New York with a lot of comments in the margin of the book and told him, get this book translated. And indeed, this book was translated in the 80s in China without our knowledge. We were not asked for permission. That was the thing they did a lot in China in the 80s. The scholars would translate a lot of books. But we had the opening up, let's see what is out there. Let's get it translated, let's discuss it to figure out what is good and what is bad and what can we use. And one of the things that were translated was LaRouche's book, No Limits to Growth. So in the 70s and the 80s, I had said, when you started out talking about LaRouche's proposal for a new just world economic order, his proposal for an international development bank. And then in the 80s, as you know, around the time and before that Phil was running for governor and mayor, LaRouche had his proposal for Operation Juarez for Latin America, where the idea was that the nations, particularly Argentina, Brazil, and Mexico, should go together and use the debt as a weapon, say, we are not going to pay this illegal debt. But they were blackmailed and threatened and so forth, and it didn't function. LaRouche also proposed the Strategic Defense Initiative at that time, and when that was refused by the Soviet Union, he said then the Soviet Union is going to collapse within 5 to 6 years. He also gave out, published LaRouche a plan, I tried to find it, I couldn't find it, called the 50-year development of the Indian Pacific Ocean, a very detailed program for economic development of the Pacific. So this is 1988, that's a very important year. This is Lyndon and Helga LaRouche in Taiwan. This is also the year that the very first proposal, and the reason I wrote it up is I would ask people, if you haven't seen it, to go in and check it out on the internet and look it up. In 1988, in October 1988, is the year of an absolutely historical webcast, or not webcast, press conference, we didn't have webcast at the time, press conference in Berlin that LaRouche gives. And this is the first public proposal for what was going to be a development of all Eurasia. And if you haven't seen that press conference, check it out on the internet. This is just an it's really a sign of genius and of LaRouche's capability of forecasting and shaping history at the same time. At that press conference, to also great surprise for his wife, he calls for the reunification of Germany, 1988, the reunification of Germany, and use that reunification, or the strength that would create, to develop the eastern part of Europe. And he says at the webcast, he says, what I'm saying here is going to be studied in a couple of hours very carefully in Moscow. He also, at this press conference, he pulls down a map of the Balkans, and he says the British are going to try to destroy that by creating a war in the Balkans. Well, a year later, Germany was reunified, and the British started a war in the Balkans. So, let me take the next. There we have, first up in the little corner, that's Berlin. The demonstrations in Berlin where the wall came down in 1989. And a month or so later, you had the demonstrations in Beijing. What people should know is that with the demonstrations in Beijing, they started out good, and they were taking over from outside, from Hong Kong, in a very dirty operation, and the people that had led the demonstrations and were ready to go back to the universities after all their demands had been okayed by the Chinese government, the demonstrations were taken over. That's the longer story, but yes. There was, they had a number of demands for the students for more freedom and
Tiananmen Square.
And so the students that then took over, I mean, Winston Lord, who was at the American Embassy at that time, personally stamped 200 visas for some of the students that were hunger strikers on the Tiananmen Square. And everybody had escape routes. The idea was to, as one of them said, we want to create a bloody shirt, so that the people will rise up. The whole thing behind it was to stop the development in China and get the hardliners back in. That didn't succeed, but that was the idea. Like a color revolution. So it started good, and you've seen that before in history, where you have a good demonstration where students were all elected and things like that, and then it's taken over from within. But that's a longer story. So at that time, this is really important. LaRouche is in jail. When you had the Tiananmen Square uprisings, LaRouche is in jail together with other people. And Helga LaRouche, now the leader of the international organization, takes upon herself now to begin with, of course, in discussions with LaRouche in jail, takes upon herself now to organize internationally a movement to free Lyndon LaRouche, but not just as a thing in itself, combining it completely with then beginning what becomes the development of the Eurasian land bridge, which then becomes into the world land bridge. Because now the borders are open. So Helga LaRouche and associates in Europe, they goes to Russia, Bulgaria, Hungary, conference and meeting nonstop. She works tirelessly. A combination of telling people what the ideas of Lyndon LaRouche is, which is the reason he is in jail, and at the same time organizing politically for these ideas which must come to fruition.
Where was he in jail?
In Virginia.
Minnesota, most of the time.
Yeah, Minnesota, yeah. First Virginia and then Minnesota. So we can talk about that later, but he was in jail for 5 years as a political prisoner. And what happened with that, which I didn't think about at the time, but in reflection, but the first proposal Helga has, which then spans out to become Eurasian land bridge development corridor, the new Silk Road, is to take Vienna, Berlin, and Paris. And the triangle in between, at that time, was the most densely populated with the highest skilled labor force and industry and machine tools in the world. So take that and then have fast speed corridors between those three cities and develop spiral arms of development going out from there. You would use that as a kernel center. And from there it just took off, and very soon you have the whole idea of the Eurasian land bridge. We literally take Sun Yat Sen's program on the international development of China, and based on that, this is the concept. But what you have is, because LaRouche is in jail, a number of people working with LaRouche do things that they would never ever have done in their life if he was not in jail. Succeed in gathering 400 parliamentarians worldwide, signing a form calling for the exoneration of LaRouche, that he is a political prisoner while he was put in jail. Ramsey Clark says this is the most political case since 1896. Former Justice Minister, that's not what it's called in US, James Mann. What is it called?
Attorney General.
Attorney General, yeah. And not numerous deans of law schools and so forth signed for LaRouche's exoneration. And when you sign for the exoneration of LaRouche, this is the United States of America. This is a powerhouse. You can be assassinated, you can be lose everything you have, whatever. For people from smaller countries to sign that LaRouche is a political prisoner and should be exonerated, and that their signature will be published in international papers with their name, then you had to really organize them in depth what LaRouche's ideas was. And in a certain way, the ideas in depth, although LaRouche was in jail and thus he couldn't do what he otherwise could do, the promotion of the ideas of LaRouche took off in a way that it had never happened before, in opening up nations, including in China. So let me This is the first time I go to China. This is Hong Kong in 1991 to a conference on the 21st century and the ideas of Sun Yat-sen. And of course, what is presented is the ideas in the international development of China and how important these ideas is. Later developments from friends that we make there is incredibly important regarding both the land bridge and the peaceful reunification between Taiwan and mainland China. Because I don't know how many people are familiar, but you have mainland China here, and then you have Taiwan here, Japan here. And for decades, Taiwan had been used as a chess piece by the oligarchy to create tension across the Taiwan Strait between mainland China and Taiwan, like Middle East is being used and so forth. And through our friends, through these years, this is LaRouche's friends who has led the reunification process between mainland China and Taiwan, so it's very doubtful at all that now they can ever play that card again, creating a war across the strait or tensions, because it's already a fact of the reunification process. It's just peaceful reunification with specific, it's just a process that is in connection with China's internal development and international foreign policy. So this year, 1991, is also when we begin to publish a Chinese newsletter, a little brother to the executive intelligence review. This is not how the first ones looked like. I was asked in 1991 to start a Chinese newsletter, and I did not want to do that. I didn't know a word of Chinese. I didn't know anything about Chinese history. It didn't interest me. I was definitely not interested. But after some probing, it took 3 weeks. I said, okay, I'm going to do it. But then, I mean, you can put yourself in my shoes. You don't know any Chinese. You don't know very much about the history. How are you going to do that? So that was a process. The first newsletters were handwritten. And I did crazy things, but it came off. So that begins, and it has a certain importance that I'll come back to later. It doesn't look much, but it has had a certain importance. Next. This is EIR from 1992. This is the first time we have the Eurasian land bridge on our cover for the EIR. So think about it. Xi Jinping, that was this October last year. This is the first time we have it on the cover of the EIR. It's 1992. And we organized for it. Many conferences, many meetings. Okay, yeah, now I was going to put them together, but it was too complicated. I'm just going to show you quickly. As I mentioned before, when LaRouche was in jail and you had to get people to sign for his exoneration, they had to know who LaRouche was and is. So one of the gentlemen I met with, Yao Yao Dong, he signed for LaRouche. He was a former economy minister. He also built the, at that time, the largest steel plant in Asia, in Taiwan. And he ended up saying after a few meetings, he said, you know what I think about LaRouche? First he said he thought LaRouche was a genius. And then he said the highest he could get, he said to me, do you know what I think about LaRouche? And no, what do you think about him? I think he's a gift from God. So he signed, but he was also crucial in pulling behind the scenes concerning policy and reunification. This is Chiang Kai-shek's son, very good friend of LaRouche, also signed. Li Guoding, former economy minister, also signed. Liang Shu-rong, he was a minister, I forget now, but also signed. Little younger guy, Sun Andi, central committee member of the KMT that he was thrown out of. Very close friend, done a lot of work behind the scenes. Then, just so you get some flesh on it, that's why I'm showing you some pictures I'm not showing you for certain specific reasons. Then, what I did is, and that's what I mean, because that's not, and it's not to push myself ahead, it's just that this is what I was involved in. Because I know we did things we would never ever have done, so I speak very little Chinese. And how do you get to talk to parliamentarians in another place? You make yourself good friends with the secretaries. And then you had to figure out who do you meet with. And then I did it in the American way. I'll kind of figure out which congressman should I go and see. And then I'll go have the secretaries tell me where to go. And then I'll sit in their office and wait. And then when they came, I'll just jump on them and begin to brief them about Lyndon LaRouche out of the blue. And that meant that in a matter of 1 month, I got 3 former ministers and 30 parliamentarians to sign for LaRouche's exoneration. But that meant also, I mean, a lot of them, most of them was total for reunification of China, totally love of Sun Yat Sen and idea about Sun Yat Sen, and totally, many of them highly steeped in Confucian classics, and therefore Lyndon LaRouche and what they represent, what they thought is good, goes completely hand in hand, and of course Lyndon LaRouche was a political prisoner. So these are 4 of the parliamentarians that signed, and they had said, one of them had said, actually the one first out to the left or to your right, but anyway, he had said, well, I will hold a press conference tomorrow in the parliament regarding LaRouche. And I said, well, that's good. And so I stood all night at a 7-Elevens in Taiwan and made copies of some of these newsletters and other things they should have. And I came in with paper bags. I had been staying all night making these copies. And I come in to the parliament, and there is big sign all the way over there, LaRouche, this is Lin's Chinese name.
Oh,
and they had already printed up in printing copy machines. I had not had to stand there for hours putting coins in 7-Elevens and so on. So that's kind of what I meant. Things, people acted in this period, and see, this is 93, right? October 93. People acted, and they did the same thing in Hungary, very, very specifically in Russia. We did an intense work in Russia concerning LaRouche's. So this is just the part that I'm very familiar with. So let me see here. Yeah, this is 1995, our Chinese newsletter. And this is Helga in Beijing in 1996. She was invited by the Chinese government, but this was not so easy. I actually had another picture, but somehow it disappeared. There was 2 gentlemen from Taiwan, that's totally for the reunification of China, who were director and vice director of something called the World Land Bridge Foundation. They're very close friends of ours. And the British were going to be at this conference too. In 1996, they argued that Helga LaRouche should not be there. And these 2 Chinese guys, they argued, of course she should, because they're the only ones in the world that are organizing for Eurasian language, for the new Silk Road. Of course they have to be there. So because you had the argumentation from within, like Chinese arguing with Chinese, that opened the doors that Helga came to China in 1996 and gave a featured speech in China on the Eurasian language. We also had things like magazines, like in Taiwan Business Weekly. They would put every single week, they would have 1 or 2 pages from the Executive Intelligence Review promoting LaRouche's ideas and so forth for years. And then we had this baby. This baby. And that was an intense work, which again also involved, this developed also through a lot of meetings with individuals, conferences, and so on. I have one one story with a very special guy who was in New York, and I took him to see LaRouche, and I will never forget the meeting. Here we were in LaRouche's living room, and my friend had studied what we had given out so far in the land bridge very carefully, and he'd made his own big maps up, like it's just a little slice of China would be a huge map. And he had drawn in what he thought where the railroad should go and what should happen and so on. So if you can imagine, this is LaRouche's living room. Here comes this Chinese fellow, and he spreads the maps out on the floor, and then he squats down and begins to explain to LaRouche. And then Lynn was in the 80s at that time, or late 70s maybe. Lynn would get down, and the knees would, he'd go up again. And then he'd be so excited, he'd get down. And it's going on for a couple of hours. And then LaRouche will say, no, this is right. Yeah, we should change it right here. Some of the key changes that we then did in the language came, for example, from that meeting and other numerous meetings, like a work in progress to see, to figure out what to do. I have a personal story also concerning this. Just a couple of months ago, I was in Washington to meet a Chinese fellow who had been in Washington, D.C. a couple of years ago, and then he had gone back to China, and then he was back just for 14 days. So I had never seen him, but I was asked to go down and see him, so I went down to see him. And there was like supposed to be an hour meeting or something. So after the first hour, he's completely into it. I'm really getting it now. I'm getting it. I didn't get it before. I'm really getting it. And then I pulled up this. And this was, remind you, this is a couple of months ago. So this is after Xi Jinping had called for the new Silk Road in Kazakhstan in October, right? So I pull this out of my bag, and he looks at it, and he sees January 1997. And he looks at me, and he looks at this. You did it! You did it! I thought it was Xi Jinping, but you did it! And then we met for another 2 hours. He was like so excited. Yeah, it was kind of really fun. So, also in 1997, this same year that the land bridge is coming out, LaRouche warns in the beginning of 1997 that Asia is going to be attacked by a financial wave of attack. And Helga LaRouche goes to mainland China and I go to Taiwan. At that time we still kept it separately, so people didn't think we were going to, we were doing bad things crossing the line. Now we can, but not at that time. So people listened politely to Helga, her war, but LaRouche was saying, you're going to be attacked, you're going to be attacked. They listened politely to me, but they didn't really believe it. And then when it happened, in the end of 1997, that indeed Asia was attacked, the respect for LaRouche just went through the roof. And this was very important also to get rid of the last part of China's wrong policy, which LaRouche had attacked for quite a while, where China wanted to develop, only focused on developing the coastal lines of China. And what they would do is they would make everything ready for foreign companies. They will, pave the roads, create electricity, water, everything so a factory could be started. They will give a tax break for 10 years or whatever. And the foreign companies could just go in and begin to use cheap labor and then export it out. And LaRouche said this is a very bad policy. It's a very bad policy. He warned and warned. And the more respect that LaRouche got from the Chinese leadership, the more they, and then they made a final complete shift inside China regarding their policies, and they began to go completely with the ideas of Sun Yat Sen and the international development of China. So now I'll go fast. Yeah, oops. This is Helga at Lianyungang, which is the end of the terminal out of the coast. Take another one. And Helga becomes the Silk Road Lady. Lu女士, Lu is wrote. So this is in New York. She has, we have so many press conferences in New York, and here we would have 5 or 6 per year. This is the reason I take that is I hold up the Eurasian language. Helga is giving the press conference. Again, you have her as a Silk Road lady. This is from, you can see, the reason I bring this is you can see what she has in the background, the development corridor. This was I never shown this picture before because this was a secret 1 week long meeting with a group of Chinese that nobody in New Jersey local, nobody knew that Lynn and Helga was in New York, and the group of Chinese that come from mainland China, we were giving classes for a whole week in New York to that group of Chinese. And again, the emphasis is what do we do? The Eurasian language, the concept of development corridors and so on. This is for a week, lunches and dinners and discussions. I have a fun one with LaRouche and this young lady. And it is so funny because after we'd done that, I took them up with one of our members who has now passed away, who was a former farmer. We took them up in upstate New York for a week to take them to American automobile factories, American farmers, modern and old-fashioned and so on. And the very first rest stop we stop at, this Chinese lady, there's a black lady behind the counter, there's a burger joint or something like that. And this young Chinese lady, she's so excited, so she says there when she's ordering her burger, "I just have spent a week with Lyndon LaRouche." And the lady says, "Oh, he's such a great man." So this is like just hilarious. It's like ordered. So yeah. So this is a conference that I was invited to give a talk about the Eurasian languages in Zhuhai. Zhu means pearl, and Hai is ocean, so it's the pearl and the ocean. It's in southern China. And I'm not showing any pictures from that. I just want, you can see the first man up there. We are on a boat to go to Macau. So I just want you to see that picture. And then, because now comes, this is LaRouche, just remember the face. This is LaRouche in Los Angeles in 2002. Mm-hmm. And there he is with the guy you saw before on the boat. Mm-hmm. This is the guy closest. And then the Consul General from Los Angeles. Mm-hmm. And LaRouche was treated very well. I remember how the Consul General stood and waited. There was nobody allowed in the room, and the Consul General stood and waited until LaRouche came, and then he led LaRouche to the table, and then everybody else would come in. Mm-hmm. LaRouche was the featured speaker. LaRouche also was a featured speaker in 2007. I'm not showing any pictures from that, also here in Los Angeles. And then just press conference after press conference. So you can see Phil sitting there to the left. The guy in the middle, some of you might remember him, very good friend of ours. He then organized for me to go and give classes in China, the guy there in the middle between Phil and me. Press conference in San Francisco, mm-hmm. Another press conference in New York. This is from 2010, see what I have in my hand? Eurasian language, okay. This is Tianjin in northern China. The guy sitting right there, oh, you can't see him, but that was the guy at the press conference who organized then for me to give classes on the Eurasian language in China. That's 2010. This is 2012 in Taipei, also on the Eurasian language. This is 2012, Eurasian language. You can see the World Bridge right there. And you can see glass, like you say, it's glass steagle, right? And now you can see the audience. It's a huge full. There was like 300 people there. very interested in the rate in the language. This is Baidu. This is the Chinese search machine. And if you put in up there in the corner, you have LaRouche's Chinese name in classical Chinese. And if you put that in, you get 109,000 results right away. If you put in his simplified Chinese, you get more. And it was kind of funny because in our old office in Verdugo Road, so you know that, where I just for fun one day, I was going in the Chinese search machine and I see all these results and I start reading and checking out the articles. And after doing that for 3 or 4 days, all day long, I look at Phil, my husband, and say, it's okay, I know there's a lot of articles, but I really can't use my entire life to check all the articles there is about LaRouche in. It is pervasive. You should know that I went to Hangzhou in the end of 2012, and they wanted specifically invitation to have somebody that was non-mainstream, which is a delightful way of getting an invitation, because that means you can do anything. I mean, you're polite and so forth, but they want specifically a non-mainstream, and the key, LaRouche is regarded as the key non-mainstream guy in America. So when I came there, see, the way it's functioning is, in one thing that is very good about the Chinese, well, there's a number, they have flaws, and one of the things that is very good is that they love classical poetry, they love to write poetry, and they read. So that is, if you give somebody literature before a meeting, they have read it when you come to the meeting, which is, of course, then you had to make sure you have read it yourself. I mean, it's clear, but so that means that the literature functions as an organizer, which is excellent. In China, too, there's not so much, it's like the jail system functions. People kind of know each other. So among the elite and the scholars and the people that are working with the government and around the government, it's not such a big group. And at that conference I went to, people wanted to come and see me because I was with the executive attendance review. I was in my hotel room preparing my speech, and one after the other come up with the conference organizer knocking on my door because they want to say hello. People were bragging that they had, everybody at that conference knew Lyndon LaRouche. This was Chinese scholars from all over the country. Actually, the conference was about the NGOs in China, because China was beginning at that point to look more seriously at the NGOs, like Russia had done, and the destructiveness of the NGOs. Like when we see in Ukraine, where 2,200 NGOs have played a crucial role in destroying this country. So the Chinese, the same with the whole thing with the Western China, Xinjiang, and so forth, the NGOs function as vehicles for destruction. There's innocent NGOs, but the major part is really bad. So everybody knew LaRouche. And sometimes when I would say Lyndon LaRouche, well, a couple of people independently each other bragged that they had met Lyndon LaRouche in China, which is not true because LaRouche was never in China. And in some cases, people say, it happened more than once too, that I would say, Lyndon LaRouche and Executive Intelligence Review, and they will turn to their colleagues and say, oh, Xila Xuehui, which is the Schiller Institute in Chinese. So they would connect LaRouche, EIR, with the Schiller Institute. So, one of the things I was told just, I got an email from one of our colleagues in Washington, D.C. His name is Bill Jones. He does a lot. He's the White House correspondent for the EIR, and he does a lot of work, institutional work with China, with the embassies and so forth in Washington. So he sent me this email where he said, I met with this scholar, and I was really impressed, Leni, from China, and he knew about LaRouche in depth. And And I said to him, how can you know about LaRouche in depth, LaRouche's ideas in depth? You never met us before. I said, oh, that's not a problem, because the National Library of China in Beijing, they have LaRouche's writings in Chinese, and they have preserved it and made it available for scholars to study. And I used to send these to all the key libraries in China. Actually, they get pictures a little bit later on. They get, that was the one I showed you before and so on. So I used to send them, and I used to, every year at the Chinese New Year, I would get 8 or 10 thank you cards from China, from the head librarian, please, in Chinese, please keep it coming, we're very happy about it. So they, in order for, this is just cheap stuff, this is printed on newspaper print, right? So they had laminated it and made it available so that, so that was just also 2 or 3 months ago I got this email that this is available at the National Library in Beijing. So apart from our Chinese website, of course. So, and what you should know about these is, this is, where is my glasses? Oh, here they are. These are all articles that are in depth concerning Lyndon LaRouche or the Eurasian language, but you have China is developing a strategy for a second Eurasian land bridge. You have, of course, this is the whole conference report. You have LaRouche's ninth forecast, the Renaissance of China, an emergency plan for the next 100 years. As this picture will show you, this talks for itself, right? Ring around China. This is by Lyndon LaRouche. You have this one. Your time is running out, building the new Silk Road. LaRouche's triple curve. Eurasian Pacific Asia axis could change history. This was LaRouche's book, Road to Recovery, that we made into a pamphlet. And on and on. How to finance the Eurasian land bridge under conditions of financial crisis. This is Sun Yat Sen's program, The Coming Land Bridge Era of Civilization, Lyndon LaRouche, Sun Yat Sen, and the New Chinese-American Partnership. So on and on and on, again, new power struggle, the Chinese Opium Wars and the American Civil War, why the British killed Lincoln. I mean, there's kind of very, this is LaRouche's, and I can just go on, this is, so you wish to learn all about economics? Which you can actually download on the website, so you get it like this and you can use it as study groups. This guy I showed you, this is up from Tianjin in northern China, where I showed this picture. The student had, I went out and talked with the students, because that's kind of fun to meet with the students, and they told me that their teacher was the best. This is our old friend and contact from Los Angeles. And that they had voted him the best teacher of all the history teachers on this big university. He was the best teacher. And then after they had met me, they said, now we know why he's the best teacher. This is because of Lyndon LaRouche. So, no secret. So, oh, what happened? Oh, here we go. This is LaRouche this year on Xinhua. Oh no, just the end of last year, sorry. 13. This is also, he has been there several times in Xinhua, I just took this up. Helge, this is a big deal. Here in March, I believe, March, she was in CNTV, which is CCTV News, which is a big deal. LaRouche was actually interviewed a couple of years ago by some contacts from here, from CCTV, and they interviewed him, but it was never brought. This was brought. And it was, if you watch it, it was not, it was very straight and hard, and it was very good. And you see they call her the new Silk Road Lady. But to bring that on CCTV is also sending a signal. The world has changed. Okay. So let me just a few things regarding China, because they have, and if you think about the BRIC countries and all these things that has been happening here the last few weeks, China, if you have been going to China regularly for the last couple of decades, you have seen a huge change. It's almost so like, it's unbelievable how, as soon as they started really focusing on in-depth infrastructure development, it has gone very fast. So they have built four corridors of fast-speed rail, north and south, and the same east and west. They have, up in the area around Tianjin and Beijing, and the province up there, they're now putting it into one area where, for example, they are taking key things out of Beijing that can be in another place to make it less congested, because all the places are very tightly connected with fast-speed rail. So, for example, it used to take between Tianjin and Beijing, it's about, I don't know, 150 miles or something, I might be wrong, but it used to take 3 hours by train in 2007. It takes 2 hours if you drive fast on a six-lane highway. It takes half an hour with a fast-speed train, which they opened up in 2008. So now they have about 11,000 kilometers in China of fast-speed rail. We don't have a single mile in the United States. And there's not a train in Europe that is as good as the Chinese trains. They don't shake, they are very quiet. And so what they also have done to all the main cities is they have, because these fast-speed rail, they take some other conditions. So they have to build new train stations. But instead of building new train stations in the middle of the cities and then disrupting everything, they build them outside the cities. And then they build new subway systems going out to there. So you take a subway, modern subway, out to the new train station, and then you take off from there. And water management, I mean, I could go talk for another hour about all these things that has been going on in China, but it is amazing. And it has taken a, has been accelerating like this. So now they have the expertise. I mean, one of the incredible, now they are, as you know, they have, or maybe you don't know, but they have proposed to build a fast-speed rail up through Siberia and up to the Bering Strait. And they also would like to build the tunnel connecting Russia and the United States. And they would very much, they have made a blueprint for that. There's actually three different blueprints I know of, because that would also give them more expertise to build a tunnel between Taiwan and mainland China.
Like Gaza.
They also, huh?
I said like Gaza.
Yeah, they also have a lot of expertise now in high altitudes and frost, because in 2008 they finished the train that you can take all the way from Shanghai across China and all the way up to Lhasa in Tibet, where three-quarters of it is in permafrost. So you can imagine the machine tools and everything that you need to operate in such area. And one of the things, for example, with water transfer, I'm not going to go into that in quite detail, but one of the ideas has been to transfer water from the tail of the Yangtze River up to the tail of the Yellow River, but it's a very rough terrain. Area with mountains and so forth, and it's cold, but now they're beginning to have the technology to be able to do that, machine tool-wise and otherwise. They are also very capable now of Siberia, of taking on Siberia in collaboration with Russia after they built that railroad up in the Himalayas. And there's now plans, and it's being put into, of course, expanding three different ways out in the western China and down Myanmar, Vietnam, and also from Himalaya into India and Bhutan. It's all being done. Actually, people say So much is being done that we need a new land bridge report, which is coming very soon, because everything we wrote in 1997 is like being put on the table. One of the most delightful things for me, I think for other people too, that was when Premier Li from China a few months ago went to Africa and proposed that China help connect all of Africa's capitals with fast speed rail. And because Africa to this day is completely in the throes of colonial thinking, setting the countries up against each other, you have this ugly stuff from the UN, how you can have solar panels so you can have hot water for your toilet, and this is what they call development for Africa. Now, fast speed rail connecting all the capitals of Africa. 13 of the nations in Africa do not have any rail. And all the rails that you have has gone for the mines and out to the coast, so you can ship the raw material that had been dug up by cheap slave labor, get it out and export it. So, and if China has already for some years been a real example for poor nations, that if China could do it, China that was so dirt poor, if they can do it, we can do it. And now they have a great helper with Russia, India, China, all of Latin America collaborating in a joint effort for a human future. So, oops, what's going on? Oh, that's just, this is how they look like. That's wonderful. And that is the Chinese projection for the Bering Strait connection. One thing also not to forget is the Chinese and space. The atmosphere in China now is like, I don't know about it, but what I could guess it was in America in the 60s and 70s, where if you want to have a real good thing on your advertisement in China, you don't take a hot bait where you can see out the boobs or something. No, you take an astronaut. Okay? That's what you take. Everybody are completely inspired and excited about the future. I couldn't help it. That is also Chinese train. I took that myself.
Maglev,
300 and no, no, that's just a fast speed rail. 325 kilometers, and it doesn't shake. It no sound. It just. Yeah.
180 miles.
And then the last, I will finish. Tianxia Weigong. Actually, I would like to end with Schiller. Where did I put him? Here we go. Because Schiller had said, what this means, this is taken from Confucius, a very, very famous writing from Confucius called the Da Tong, the Great Commonwealth.
Da Tong Jian.
Yeah. And thank you. And this is the handwriting of Sun Yat Sen. If I knew you were Chinese, I would not have written my Chinese on the board. But anyway, what it means is that Qian means heaven. So that everything under heaven belongs to people, or the world belongs to everybody. And the ideas of Confucius concerning man and man's relationship to the universe goes totally hand in hand by the most beautiful ideas about man and man's relationship to the universe we have from the West. Confucius believed that we are all born with certain innate qualities. The highest of those are love, love on the highest level, justice, love of justice, knowledge, love of knowledge, and others, and that it is your duty as a human being to develop those qualities to the fullest. And when you do so, the only way you can develop your qualities is free of deceit. And you can often cheat somebody else, but you can never really cheat yourself. So if you really are going to be a human being, Confucius say, you have to it's your duty to develop all the qualities you have been born with, and you can only do it with, if you're without deceit. And then when you do that, then you can, together with heaven and earth, form a triunion, and that fulfills your destiny as a human being. Confucius say that the universe is lawfully ordered, that the moon and the sun knows where to go, and they never bump into each other, they're never wrong. And that man's relationship to the universe should be the same, and ever in a harmonious, ever-changing relationship. So concerning ideas about man, we take the most beautiful things from India, from Russia, from the United States, from China, and it's lawful that those ideas are the same. They might be expressed in a little different, but they are the same, and that's lawful because of the way mind, the man's mind is functioning. I wanted to end with, and this is, I mean, we are just on the edge for a new worldwide renaissance. It's very dangerous now because the oligarchy is like a rat in a corner, and a rat in a corner is not very nice. So we cannot flinch, we cannot fantasize. We have to have a total respect and admiration and thankfulness for the people that fought before us and that now died, and then stand on their shoulder and finish the job and win America back. And Schiller says, when I was young, I couldn't really understand it. It sounded nice. But he said, in the ninth letter, the aesthetic letters, he says, "Give then a reply to the young friend of truth and beauty, who would learn from me how he can satisfy the noble desire in his breast in the face of all the opposition of the century. Give to the world on which you act the direction towards the good, and the quiet rhythm of time will bring about its development." Well, that is what the work that we did through the decades did. That is what, and now we have to finish the job. This is what John Quincy Adams, although everything was falling apart around him, this that he kept fighting the last 18 years of his life meant that Lincoln could do what Lincoln did. If it hadn't been also for him, the North would not have been organized against slavery. John Quincy Adams was crucial in doing that. So I was going to read something from Steele, but I should finish now. But we have a duty to continue to shape history with ideas, and in that way we make all the great people from the past alive, and we create an immortality for the species, for the human species, which is really what we have to do, right? So that's it. Any questions? Yep.
The late Ray Bradbury would have loved your presentation. We spoke quite a bit about the saints.
Mm-hmm.
And I have two quickie questions. The first one is Yat Sen's book.
Sun Yat Sen?
Yeah, Sun Yat Sen. Is it available in English translation?
Oh yeah, you can get it on the internet. Which one do you mean?
The first, what
the vital problem of China. Go in and go in on the Amazon.com or whatever,
okay,
and see, look for used copies.
Okay.
But you should take the one which has the title, The Vital Problem of China. That's the best translation.
Okay. Right.
And this one you can just get on the internet.
Alright. And then my other question, just for the benefit of those who are here that may not know what NGOs are, could you just explain?
Non-government organizations. So for example, when the United Nations General Assembly, and I've tried that a few times, when they begin in September, New York City, particularly around the United Nations buildings, are completely being descended upon by the NGOs. So, and then you have all these side meetings and conferences and so forth. Tons of money are being put into the NGOs by people like Bill Gates and George Soros. Mm-hmm. And other, you have some NGOs, non-government organizations. You have some NGOs which are very innocent, like people going out helping women how to plant better, use their land or something. It's all in a very small, it's not something that changes very much. But the real nasty stuff is the NGOs that goes in and directly are using themselves and are being used to put up opposition to the government, create internal tensions and so forth, like in Ukraine. It was directly, and that is documented, Ukraine was direct, one of the key vehicles was the 2,200 NGOs in Ukraine. And that's what you have massive in Russia. They have cleaned up the NGOs, which are getting a lot of tax-free money and things like that. And it looks like nice and innocent on the surface. We have given, we have written quite a bit about it. So you should, we should be able to give you some. Yes?
On the question of NGOs, do they like distribute drugs and stuff? Like just like medicine?
That I don't know. But it's not nice.
It's just that I've seen one post and a drug for a hemophiliac, which is, you know, they bleed and they don't stop. It was actually tainted with an AIDS virus. And it was, when that was found out here in the United States, it got banned in the United States, but the drug companies, you know, sold it over in Europe but didn't tell anybody that it was tainted.
Mm-hmm. No, that I know. One thing I would like to really see, I know people that are here for the first time, I know some people here for the first time, I would really ask you to get the latest EIR, which has a detailed going in depth of what just happened down in Latin America, of the BRICS meeting. And then you can also go in on China Daily website. If you scroll all the way down and to the right, it says Xi Jinping and the BRICS, or something like that. And you go in there, and there's page after page of all the different things, initiatives that Xi Jinping took while that trip. But since this is blacked out completely, like we, being in Congress last week, one out of five congressional offices know about that half the world population decided to create a new world order last week and got together. They don't know it. If you look at the different press, it's blocked out. And therefore, you know, if it's not in the television or Los Angeles Times, it doesn't exist, right? So therefore, it's very important that you individually work it through in depth so you get an idea about the enormity of this. This is it is sending shiver down City of London and Wall Street right now. It is a this is LaRouche's policy for a new just world economic order. This is the ideas upon which this nation was founded. And it has LaRouche written all over it, and they know it. In we couldn't do it earlier, but over all these decades and how far it has come, and then extra putting the dot over the I with Argentina standing up against the tyrant, actually increasing people coming together around standing up for development and for the future. So I think I would like to kind of end our discussion around what we need to do, that people really need to understand in their guts what happened last week, and then look upon a historical perspective, and then be part of the history now to make sure that indeed we do have a complete paradigm shift, that we finish the work. I mean, we are so close, so now we have to finish the work, and that is here in the United States of America. And that means getting marching orders from the organizers here regarding what you can do regarding your congressman, what you can do concerning contributing, what how you can organize house meetings, whatever. But it is now. As human beings, I mean, we shouldn't be able to look ourselves in the mirror without doing everything we can now for the successful future of mankind. We can become extinct now, but we also have the greatest opportunity ever. And that is what I think we should focus on, getting knowledge in depth about what actually happened, and then what we need to do here in America for the next short period ahead on all levels. Okay? Without knowledge, see, that's the idea, shared history, but if you don't know, you're not more worse than a dog.
We can see the progress of the new world economic order since the formation of BRICS nation and its new development bank. However, the oligarchy may have strategies to sabotage this. How can we combat this? How EIR, the Executive Intelligence Review, can play a role on this?
The absolutely key thing is what we are doing nationwide and in Washington right now, that is the combination of an intense barrage, I think you call it, from citizens here in the United States concerning their organizing your fellow people around you, what is going on now, the danger of it and the opportunity, and that at the same time calling Congress. And we can give you very clear instructions so that it comes like one focused shot. We have people that have been calling 100 congressmen, just sitting one after the other, a big push. Have house meetings. It's funny because here in America, I often have gotten this from foreigners, because I've done a lot of work at the United Nations, and I've often gotten, how come LaRouche is so respected in my country, and nobody here knows him, or nobody likes him, seems to like him here in the United States? It's because of fear. The respect and love for LaRouche is just under the surface. We have operated here for decades. And you know it when you're out organizing. You have these people, and they come up as if they don't know anything, and then it turned out they've been following LaRouche for 30 years or for 20 years or whatever. People are just terrified. And it's up, LaRouche said the other day, that we have to be a resistance. Not just to a silly resistance, but the way in which, like a Martin Luther King, where you come into a room or you're together with a bunch of friends or whatever people you think are your friends, that you are steely standing up for truth and what needs to happen and try to become as strong as possible your self-concerning knowledge of the ideas what needs to be done, and then you organize others around you. And even whatever is being thrown at you, you stand up for that. And then you give other people the courage to nurture these ideas and to stand up for truth. But we have to be the Martin Luther Kings of today, every one of us, for example, in this room. We have to give other people optimism and courage that you can fight. But if people just put their tail between their legs and are just sweet and nice and just kind of want to be light, then you're just like a slave and nothing changes. So I mean it very serious when I said the latest EIR, read it carefully, call the organizers, ask questions, and then you organize people around you, because it has to come from the American population, putting pressures on each other and Washington. What Phil started out saying concerning this vote is earth-shattering. What happened 2 weeks ago in Latin America is earth-shattering. You and I have never experienced anything like this in our entire adult life. But we could also have a horrific war. So now it's to win. We must win America back now. The best battle anybody here in America can do now is to be right here and win that battle, participating in us winning that battle, because this is for mankind as a whole. This is the most crucial battle we have now on the globe we have in the United States in these coming days and weeks. And if you feel little sometimes, I'm not saying you, I'm just talking generally, then call one of the organizers, discuss what to do, what you can do, and get the guts up. Yes?
So it being my first time here, you said something about people being fear holding them back. How can you get over that fear? Or how can you overcome that fear?
That's a good question. Well, you, one of the things that Schiller says, right, Friedrich Schiller, and you should actually maybe come and read it with us, because we're going to read it Monday on the Sublime by Schiller, where Schiller says that if there is, and he says, if there's a thing that you must and that you don't will, then you're not free. And then he says, we all must die, but if you don't will to die, then you are not free. Okay, but he doesn't say you should commit suicide or something like that. But what he means is that if it is so that you are scared, if it is so that you think in terms of your personal comfort, your physical safety and so forth, and are scared about that, then you are not free. You're controlled by your body, that you have to stay alive, and so, and that this comes first. That is what made Martin Luther King so powerful. Even when his wife and children were bombed, he didn't stop. And he knew he was going to be killed. The last speech he gives, I've been on the mountaintop, I find is very sublime, because he thinks, he knows that he's soon going to die, but he's not going to stop fighting. He's going to face that he's going to die. And so that's something you have, each one of us have to work on, that what is the most important thing in your life? Is that you are physically alive, or is that to stand up for principles and truths? And so that you can live, how can you be a real human being, that you can be proud of yourself to be the one you are and look in your mirror, that you are a principled person that's standing up for truths and fighting for truths. And that's the gift you then get, because then you're more and more of a human being. But that's, anyway, maybe I could do it better, but that's what I'll answer for now. Yep.
A quick question, you know, if Obama would be impeached, there would be another American president, then how are you sure that there would be no danger of war? There's another person.
Were you there in the beginning when Phil gave the briefing? Were you there in the beginning when Phil Rubinstein gave the briefing?
No, she came
earlier. Oh, okay. Because this is something that comes up often. Obama is the key puppet for the British Empire. And there has been a complete control until now in the House and Senate, where the Democrats have not dared do anything and the Republicans have not wanted to have him impeached because they're thinking about winning the next election and things like that. Yesterday there was a complete shift because for the first time in decades the Republicans and the Democrats came together to vote against the war. Now you see, concerning political processes, you cannot think in terms of one person goes out and another person comes in. That's not how it's functioning. This nation, you have had a huge fight for Glass-Steagall. You have had a huge fight to get the 28 pages from September 11th to come out. You've had a huge fight regarding the NSA spying. A huge fight regarding Obamacare. But everything has been kept in control because of the White House and the control of the president in the White House. This control is beginning to go. The vote yesterday in the House was an earth-shattering event where it was totally bipartisan of 90% of the House voting against the war. This has not happened, for 50 years or something. So the question about, and there was also in Phil's briefing how from the White House spokesman, they take the question about impeachment very serious. When you have a question about the impeachment of Obama, the whole system is shaken to the ground. And everything as a geometry, as a political process, is opened up. If you then have in this process, and you really have to think in terms of the way history is functioning and the political processes are functioning, it is like a geometry where if you put maybe just a little thing into it, it can change everything. LaRouche often have said to us, hypothesize all the time. If something happens, what will it mean for them? We just had half the world going for the American system of economic policy, calling for a new economic order, vouching to go against IMF, Wall Street, and City of London, and stand together for in-depth infrastructure development. That happened in the 15s and the 16s, and then the days following. So you have that situation in the world, which is not in the press. That's why I told people to get the IR and read it. And at the same time, you have this horrible situation in the United States, politically, foreign policy and internal policy. So this would be like you put the you had a bottle of champagne and you shake it and you get the bottle off and the bottle flies out and everything is uncorked. That's what Obama's impeachment would mean. All the terror of control, of blackmails and so forth, in this political geometry, gone. So, okay. Okay.